stops you and asks for your driver's license, you don't expect this.
Can I see your license, please?
Get a car! Get a car! Get on the ground! Get on the ground!
I just got my license. You can't get my license. I've got my license right here. That's my license right there.
Put your hands behind your back. Put your hands behind your back. Put your hands behind your back. Put your hands behind your back.
Especially when you do exactly what the officer asked. 35-year-old LeVar Jones was shot in the hip and managed to survive. With a U.S. trooper, he's facing up to 20 years in prison. So we might see some accountability. Here's a video, though, from New York. Was pregnant, visibly pregnant. But something tells me these NYPD officers might not have to answer for their offense caught on camera. Why? Because it happens all the time. Solomon Kamasan, founder of Your World News Media Collective and producer of state-sponsored slavery documentary, joins us in the Now tonight. Thanks so much for being with us. This is becoming such a reoccurring trend that there's a course for police officers involved in shooting incidents over how to win the media over. They boost this company of essential skills you can get that are needed to deal with fallout after you shoot someone. What does this say about the state of what was initially meant to be a service to the people?
Yeah, well, it says that the institution of policing in the United States of America is rogue by nature. It's corrupt by nature. And we also know it's institutionally racist by nature. It shows that what I would call the fourth branch of the U.S. government, the corporate media in the U.S., the CNNs, the MSNBCs, the Fox Newses, and the like, they routinely, when there is an incident of police brutality, they oftentimes, have this cloud of doubt that is hovering over the victims. Instead of covering the story from the ground up and covering it in an impartial manner.
You mean always trying to find what the victim did wrong to provoke this?
Exactly. Routinely they do that. Methodically they do that.
How does one protect themselves from the police nowadays? I mean, one organization working for justice, I believe in New York, literally has put up a set of rules which you should follow not to be abused, attacked, or even shot out. How far is this going to go? And do people need to start learning how to protect themselves from the police?
Yeah, at the very least, I mean, that's what folks have to do. I mean, as an activist in the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area, that's what I've been doing with young people, trying to educate them, making sure that they know the Bill of Rights, the first 10 amendments, that they know exactly how to conduct themselves when they're stopped, because you don't have to be doing anything wrong to be stopped by the police. Just, you know, minding your own business. I mean, it's happened to me on countless occasions. And so, but depending on what police officer you're dealing with, when they pull you over, if you make some kind of furtive movement, you know, that's a cause for them to shoot first and ask questions later. So we have to educate our communities, community by community, especially young people, in terms of how to compose themselves and how to record everything from the badge number to the license plate number, keeping your composure so that the battle against police misconduct and hopefully doesn't escalate to police brutality, because sometimes there is no follow-up battle for that individual. Oftentimes that individual lose their lives, but hopefully it just stays that misconduct and so that the battle against that misconduct can be fought in civil courts and legal courts and so forth. And so it's really important at the very least for communities and individuals to arm themselves with the know-how, the information in terms of how to combat, you know, the police, you know, non-violently when you approach, because it's something that honestly they have the guns. I mean, you know, you have to, you know, we have to find ways in which we can avert, you know, any more of these tragedies that continue to go on. And I wanted to add one thing: the root of the police in the United States of America starts with slave patrols. The first police in the United States of America were nothing other than slave patrols. They were protecting the property, the so-called property of plantation owners, slave owners. And so when a slave, an African slave, absconded, that that slave patrol, those police, the original police, they were, their job was to go out and to recapture those, you know, those enslaved Africans, recapture them, bring them back to their plantations.
Solomon, I'm going to have to stop you there because we do have a guest that we want to join on the line whose son was actually a victim of police brutality. Thank you so much, though, for joining us. And the now founder of Your World News Media Collective and producer of state-sponsored slavery. Do check out his documentary film.
Thank you. No problem.
Well, like Solomon was saying, sometimes such standoffs with the police do end in tragedy. I want to bring in the now tonight Hawa Ba. It's been exactly 2 years since her 28-year-old son, Mohammed, was shot to death by police officers. Tell us, please, your story. How did your son end up dead?
Yes, my story. Good afternoon for everybody. First, I'm so happy to be with you people who curious what's happening in New York here city, special for the NYD police. I came here celebrating my son's birthday. Arrive here, meet my son sick. And when I meet my son sick, I call one of my friends who is a teacher, ask him, tell him that my son's sick, he's not feeling well. He asked me what how I feel. I say, he talking, it's not street, and he just in his house. He got womb already. I need to take him to the hospital. He say, okay, it's an adult help here. We'll call those people. They will help us to take him to the hospital. She called those people, and they say, do he used to smoke? We say, no, we didn't see. Do he used to drink? We said, no, we didn't see. He say, okay, what you people will do, call an ambulance, take him to the hospital. They can do general checkups. That they can give him treatment.
So you called. Say, okay, you called. I just want to get this.
Because
I just want to get this correct. You were calling for help, for medical help for your son. That was the phone call you made, and the police came.
I called an ambulance.
And
yes,
the police
I call
came.
An ambulance. When you're listening to them, the police came, and I tell them, oh, I don't call police. I call an ambulance. They say, oh, ma'am, don't worry. Here, when you call an ambulance, we will come first. He said, when we see the sick person, we'll call the ambulance. We walk together, they knock the door. I said, go away. They walk together, they knock my son door. He opened the door. He said, oh, police, you knock on the wrong door. Go away. I don't call you. They say, oh, no, I came to you. They wanted to force enter on his door. He locked the door and go back to bed. I want to talk to my son. He said, oh, mom, don't worry. Go down. We'll talk to him. We'll take him to the hospital. He will get well. Don't worry. We started going to fifth floor, going down to the second floor. I started seeing people with seals, hammers, and things. I said, hey, why those people going? Let me talk to my son. He will open the door. He said, no, no, don't worry. Go outside. He will be okay. We'll take him to the hospital. They push us to go outside, just telling us he will be okay. Let's go outside. He will be okay. Arrive outside, say, ho. Who you know here? I said, what you mean who I know here? I don't understand who I know here. I just meet my son sick. I want to take him to the best hospital. I will pay for it. I call for that help. He said, don't worry, he will get well.
And at this time Mohammed had been shot by the police. Is that correct?
In his bed. No, no, no. At that time, he was in his bed. At that time, he was in his bed. They just drove us outside. Then they come, broke his door, shot him. On her own room.
Because the police report, says that he was armed with a knife and that the police had thought that he actually was stabbed by him.
Yes. Now they said that one make they don't indict them. Now we're on the federal court. Then the lawyer asked him, okay, you say Mr. Ba have a knife. But the mom said, let me talk to my son. You didn't upset her. And she said, maybe those people don't understand my English. Send two people to talk to you. You should let her talk to her son. Okay, we hear you. Why the knife you say Mr. Ba have? Because of that knife you kill him. They say, oh no, we don't have the knife. We have the paper. They say, okay, what's wrong with the knife? He say, oh, the heroes can take the knife. Heroes can take the knife. Swipe to the swim, swipe to the ocean. The people say no, the lawyer say we got to go further of that. You cannot say the only evidence you got to say you killed a sick person who is in her own apartment, students who live for her parents because he have the knife. You don't have the knife, we need justice for Mohamed Bah. Not just for Mohamed Bah alone, for the future children who growing up here, for the future generation who growing up here.
All right,
as
Hawaba,
a mother of Ahmad Jallo, Sombel.
I'm going to have to stop you there. Such a terrible story, really. I do hope you do find justice for your son, if that can be said after he's dead. Of course, the two-year anniversary of Mohamed Bah being shot by NYPD officers 2 years ago today. Thank you so much for joining us in the now.